Good evening. I'm Glenn Johnson of KWSU Television News, and tonight a special report on the Palouse fallout. We'll have experts in the field of agriculture, vet science, people from public safety, geology, and the administration all exploring the after effect of this volcanic fallout. The picture around Mount St. Helens today is one of devastation. Mike James of King Television.
Right now you're looking down the Toutle River Valley. You can see steam coming off the water. Meltwater, probably warmer than the air at that point, which was about 40 degrees. It's a little bit hard to appreciate the great depth of these gorges which have been cut. There's probably a 100-foot drop between the top and the bottom, which we are now zooming in on. Mud continues to flow, as you can see, at the bottom of this valley. Although it has a much more watery consistency than it did yesterday, it is not as thick. It is just a landscape that goes on and on. No sign that the dense stands of trees once stood here. A lush green landscape, the elk which used to use this area. Those are all gone, buried under tons of ash and mud and silt. You can see where the timber has just been blown in one direction, many of these areas. It's probably a hot gust of wind. They have what they call a nuée ardente, an avalanche of glowing gas, very hot gas, ranging anywhere from 700 to 1,000 degrees Celsius at the source, cooling as it goes, but cooling only by comparison. You can see the damage and destruction it can wreak. Whole stands of timber just felled. No foliage left, just totally incinerated. Again, this was all dense stands of timber, just gone.
In Pullman and Washington State University, the scenes around here today look much like a ghost town, something out of an old West movie, or perhaps even out of Star Wars when you look at some of the outfits that people wore. A few students braved 8 o'clock classes only to find classes were canceled just 20 minutes later. We'll have an interview with President Glenn Terrell on what prompted that decision coming up in this report tonight. One of the major concerns now is getting the Palouse functioning again, and that task falls on the city administration. Kevin Penrod talked to Mayor Pete Butkus.
Mayor Butkus, have you got any special advice you'd like to relay to Pullman residents about how they should go about cleaning up some of this mess? Any special guidelines you'd like to give them?
Well, yes, a few words. First of all, we're asking that people, if they can, sweep or shovel this ash like snow from their sidewalks into the gutter in front of their home.
You don't want them to use water, do you?
Well, we found in trying to water down some of the streets today that it takes an awful lot of water to get this stuff to move. You wet it down and then it forms a real thick slurry, and it takes a lot of water to move it afterwards. So if you shovel it or sweep it first and then use water to hose off your sidewalk, it'll work much better.
One thing we're really curious about, has the governor gotten in contact with you about any state or federal funding to help clean up this problem, this mess we've got over here?
Well, at the time of this interview, it's about 1:45 in the afternoon, and we have heard nothing from the governor's office nor from the State Department of Emergency Services. It kind of makes you wonder if they even care if we're alive over here. In contrast, Representative Tom Foley's office called this morning, expressed a great deal of concern about what they could do to help us, and we did make, through the mayor's office, an emergency request for help in Foley's office getting a hold of the private sector and shipping as many air filters for vehicles into the area as possible, additional gas masks for public safety, fire, police, and ambulance personnel, and additional surgical type masks for the rest of us that just have to be out in this mess.
Now, I know there's one thing that everybody's curious about, and has the Pullman water supply been damaged by this volcanic ash at all?
No. We have an entirely closed system. The water is drawn from wells, it goes into water mains, and is stored in closed and covered reservoirs. So there's no chance of water contamination here in Pullman.
Now, I know that everybody's been hard hit by this volcanic ash, and we anticipate another cloud coming over here pretty soon, but is there any way that Pullman can enlist aid from anybody else around in the area, anybody that isn't as hard hit?
Anybody that's close enough to help us also has the same kind of problems, and Once again, we're talking now, it's about a quarter to two in the afternoon. I recognize this will be aired later, but the wind is coming up, and most of the major highways in eastern Washington are still closed. So, for example, we could call Seattle and they could drive over here, but they might never get here.
Mm-hmm.
So we're pretty much on our own.
Except now, how do the state and county crews located in Colfax, or the county and city crews, how are they relegated out?
Well, the county responsibility is primary to county roads, and the state's, of course, is to state highways. This dust is so fine, it can't be picked up with a street sweeper, and it can't be plowed. So we're kind of in a jam. All we can really do is wait for a wind to blow it away, or a good rainstorm, or in the case of city government, to try and flush it off with street flushers.
So to summarize, you'd like to have the Pullman residents try first to sweep all this stuff off, treat it just like snow.
Yeah, a nice dry powder snow. Sweep or shovel it off and then come by and hose it off with your water.
And not worry about the water, any water damage. The Pullman water supply is safe.
The Pullman water supply is safe. And one other note of caution, a number of people have talked about what about our water supply. If there is any problem with our water supply, we will be notifying people through the local radio stations.
Now, one final note. How would the Office of the Mayor here in Pullman get state or federal aid? I mean, can you contact Governor Ray, or does she contact you? Don't call us, we'll call you thing.
Well, essentially, we would go through the Department of Emergency Services and declare Whitman County a disaster area. And from there, a number of counties usually get together, and the mayor's office would be included in that. The governor's office would then declare this part of the state a disaster area. It then goes to the president, who then declares that part of the state that's been designated by the county commissioners, the mayors, and the governor as a disaster area. Disaster assistance really doesn't do anything to help us right now, today. All it does is help governments pay for some of their expenses and the cost of cleanup, or providing food and shelter for people after it's been expended.
Well, I'd like to thank you for coming and talking to us today. Mayor Butkus, been talking with Mayor Pete Butkus of Pullman.
There are many concerns expressed in the content of this volcanic ash. WSU's geology department has been running tests on that all day, and Nancy Jackson has that story.
We have in the studio with us at this time two geologists from Washington State University. Directly to my right, Dr. Peter Hooper, who's been doing various work on volcanoes from time to time, and also Dr. Victor Swan, who just at about 12:10 this morning finished his thesis on volcanoes, specifically Mount Baker. I'd like to start with you, Dr. Hooper. What is the ash outside made of?
Well, the ash is composed primarily of glass shards. The lava blown into the air cools and comes down as little splinters of glass. And the ash is composed mainly that it's fairly light and travels a long way. There are also some crystals of feldspar and some crystals of quartz and some crystals of amphibole in it, but it's mainly glass shard and it's pretty light material.
Mm-hmm. Is it dangerous?
I don't think it's a darn nuisance, but I don't think it's necessarily very dangerous. We were told yesterday that the pH was 4.7, which is mildly acidic. It's gritty, of course. If it gets in mechanical parts, it can cause trouble. I shall be brushing it off my car as carefully as I can, and when I brush off all I can, I shall wash it off. But I don't regard it as very dangerous.
Mm-hmm.
Nuisance, but not dangerous.
We've heard hints from all over the place that it's not a good idea to directly use water to wash it off of cars. Is that true?
Well, the only answer to that, I think, is that if you try and do that with that thickness, you'll just produce a lot of mud, and then you may have to wipe it off. If you start having to wipe it off, you may scratch,
mm-hmm.
because it's scratchable material. It will scratch. It's little bits of sand and feldspar crystals are hard. They will scratch your paint off your car.
Okay. How about the rumors that mixing water with it will produce an acidic solution?
Well, it isn't acid until it's with water. And then you have this mild acidic solution will be produced at 4.7,
okay.
But very mildly acidic, I think.
Okay. Dr. Swan, can we expect another explosion and more ash?
Well, I think, Cheryl, this is one of the problems with the Cascade volcanoes is we don't really know what to expect. This is the first one that has erupted since 1917, Mount Lassen, and at that time we had very, very few scientific instruments to monitor that explosion with. There is no doubt about it that one could say with safety it will erupt in the future. The problem is what future? When? Does that mean an hour from now, a day from now, or a year, or another 100 years? We just really don't know. There is probably at least a relatively high probability we will get some ash. Now, I don't know how much, and I wouldn't attempt to predict. But we probably have not seen the last of the ash fall, although hopefully it'll be much less than what we have seen thus far.
Mm-hmm. Is a cloud like the one we experienced yesterday a normal thing with an explosion of this type?
Well, probably yes. Now, again, this magnitude of eruption that we have all lived through has not been witnessed, experienced very often. There have been some in recorded history, yet so many times our communication was so very poor, say in the early 1900s, that we don't really know how these things traveled at that time.
Okay. One last quick question, gentlemen. We are running out of time. Some people have died on Mount St. Helens. What did they die of?
They basically died of the hot blast. After the major Plinian-type explosive eruption yesterday, there was a series of hot blasts that came out the lower down and shot very hot air, apparently no lava. Often they have lava with them, but in this case they had no lava, but at a very high temperature, and apparently scoured an area at least 30 miles long, including Spirit Lake, and everything disappeared in it. People, anything that was there, not even tree stumps are left. A trailer, the USGS trailer, has disappeared. They can't even locate where it was. This was what caused the real damage.
Okay. Apparently those people may not ever have known what hit them, because they may have been knocked unconscious or killed instantly by the sonic blast from the initial eruption.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Dr. Hooper, Dr. Swan, I'd like to thank you both for taking the time and coming into the studio with us. Thank you.
Thank you.
At this point, agricultural experts are mixed on the effect of what this has to do on crops. Here's Kathi Goertzen with that story.
Okay, I'm here talking with the chairman of the Department of Horticulture and Landscape Architecture, Dr. Orrin Smith. Dr. Smith, we're dealing with a lot of unknowns, I'm sure, but have you got any idea of what the effect of all this ash is going to have on the crops or the plants in the area?
Well, obviously, Kathi, we don't know specifically, but we do have scientists at WSU who are attempting to analyze the ash. At this point, preliminary tests show that there's about a pH of 4.7, which is somewhat acidic. We don't know the other components at this point in time, so I guess basically we have to consider this as somewhat similar to the clouds of dust that we get in from the basin. So we're trying to treat it in that way at this time.
Is there anything that can be done by a farmer or for people that have plants they're worried about?
Well, our biggest concern at this point would be those very, very young seedlings that may be covered completely, and there could be a smothering effect. Those plants that are taller, we feel that if the winds continue, which I understand they're starting to blow now, that will knock most of the dust off the leaves and therefore shouldn't be very much danger. Our greatest concern, I think, is a small amount of moisture that would get on the leaves, and that might possibly cause a chemical reaction, which could be more devastating than the dust is at this time. So at this point, we're suggesting to people that they're concerned about plants in their yards to perhaps just brush the dust off with brooms or other means, and not to wash them off with a small amount of water.
Washington State University College of Veterinary Medicine has been swamped with calls most of the day from pet owners wondering if their small animals will be damaged by this particular volcanic ash. So far, the veterinary clinic has not treated any pets for ash inhalation. But Dr. Jack Alexander, who is chairman of the Department of Vet Clinical Medicine, told reporter Chris Weatherman that it's best to keep your animals inside.
Do you think the volcanic ash will pose any problem to area pets and companion animals? Well, I certainly think there are possibilities, Chris. I think the same rules should apply to pets as they are recommending for the owners, that we should keep pets indoors, that if there is any exposure to the ash, it would probably cause perhaps a bit of eye inflammation, a conjunctivitis, but it should be nothing too severe. I think in contrast to our large animals that are out in the fields, our small animals and pets tend to live much longer, so that you're looking at some dogs that will be 10, 11, 12 years old that have had histories of respiratory disease, and in such cases this ash would be irritating. So that once again, I think it's a matter of keeping the pets indoors, and if there is a flare-up of respiratory disease, then one should contact the veterinarian.
Now, what should someone do if their dog or cat has gone outside and got volcanic ash on themselves? What would you suggest?
Well, again, the recommendations are that you should not wash the animals particularly. I think if you brush them well, some animals like to be vacuum cleaned, and you can actually take the vacuum cleaner to them. I think if you take a paper towel and moisten it with some mineral oil or some hand lotion, you will remove a lot of the irritating dust and dust that would normally be carried into the house.
What effect does this ash have on livestock? And with that angle, here's Kathi Goertzen.
We're talking with Dr. Rod Preston, the chairman of the Department of Animal Science. Dr. Preston, are there any immediate problems to livestock owners, anything they should be aware of right away?
Kathi, we can only speculate at this point in time, but based upon analyses of other volcanic type materials and the fact that this ash is really just basically fine soil particles, we don't really anticipate any immediate toxicity or problems to livestock, cattle and sheep and so on. There is one thing that we're investigating, that is fluorine. Fluorine has been reported in volcanic ash material near volcanoes at other places. We do not have a fluorine analysis on this material yet, but this is coming and we'll have that shortly, but probably that'll be pretty well confined to within a few miles of the volcano itself. So as far as livestock are concerned, probably will not be a problem. So no, there doesn't seem to be any acute toxic possibilities in this ash material.
Now, what about their feed and water? Are there any specific things?
That is the thing that is really of concern, in that, especially in these areas where we're looking at more than, say, about an inch of this ash material on forage, namely range or pasture. With that kind of covering, I think that probably livestock will just not recognize that range material, that forage is being fed any longer. And unlike cattle or sheep in the wintertime, when there's a snow that will forage down through the snow and get feed, they probably just won't recognize this as feed and will stand along fences and literally starve themselves to death looking for feed. So the first recommendation is, in fact, for animals that are outside depending upon forage for their feed supply, to get some supplemental source of feed to them, either hay or silage or some other harvested feed. Feed these cattle and sheep, say, about a half feed of material, of the supplemental feed, so that they aren't forced to eat this material. The other problem that can come if animals are forced to sort of nose through this material looking for feed is that they'll inhale the dust itself, because their noses are right down there in the dust, and can cause some emphysema problems or some lung problems that would kind of be long term. So for those two reasons, just to dilute out the feed and get feed material to them, and also to prevent this inhalation of dust to come with supplemental feed. The water supply is another important thing, and we noticed out here this morning that when we started cleaning out the watering tanks and watering bowls on cattle where this had been exposed to this ash fallout, the animals apparently hadn't drunk the water all night long. As soon as we started cleaning this out, why the cattle came up and drank. Cattlemen and sheepmen need to make sure their animals have got a source of water, that they're drinking the water. And if they're not, then they've got to get a supply of water either to the animals or take them to water.
Okay, now horses, you were mentioning, had some sort of a more susceptible lung.
That's right, Kathy. They do. They have much more problem with lung emphysema, which is called heaves in horses, difficult breathing. This comes from dusty feed. Obviously, this ash presents dusty feed, so that if horses are being fed material that is contaminated with this dust or ash fallout, they ought to use a sprinkling can or some source of water and just sprinkle the feed down in order to hold that dust down so they don't inspire it as they're eating the hay or other material that they're being fed. So that would be fairly critical with horses.
Okay. Any other immediate problems that you see?
No, certainly if anybody experiences some unknown problems in their animals, I'd certainly encourage them to contact their local veterinarian and the extension agent and call the Animal Science Department or the veterinary school here at Washington State University.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Rod Preston, chairman of the Animal Sciences Department.
Fallout has touched a wave of medical preparedness throughout the area. Kevin Penrod has been working on that story for most of the evening. Kevin, what's the latest?
Well, Glenn, in Lewis and Director of Nursing at St. Joseph's Hospital, Elizabeth Schumacher, reports that six patients have been treated for asthmatic conditions that are suspect from the volcanic ash. Most area medical centers seem to be coping with the problem pretty well. Many administrators, though, fear the effects the volcanic dust may have on their elderly patients. Schumacher told KWSU News that no noticeable influx of elderly patients have sought treatment at St. Joe's. Across the river in Clarkston, Tri-State Memorial Hospital also reports that no real difference in respiratory cases have been encountered by the hospital's emergency ward. The staff of Tri-State Convalescent Center in Clarkston are keeping their elderly patients protected from respiratory ailments as best as can be expected. Tri-State Administrator Lon Freeberg told me that the nursing home staff was working hard to keep volcanic ash free from any of the entryways and keep their patients, treating them rather, for minor cases of coughing and runny noses. One final note here in Pullman Memorial staffers have not experienced any increase in their patient load today either because of the volcanic fallout. Director of Student Health, Dr. Betty Adams, though, reported to us that several people came to the hospital in search of surgical masks for protection. Now, the hospital quit giving out the masks early this afternoon when they ran out of them. However, Dr. Adams asked us that we report that Chuck's Hardware in Pullman remained open today and probably will again tomorrow to sell the masks. They're used by painters, and they cost 34 cents apiece. Authorities still warn you, please, if you have to go outdoors for any reason, wear a mask that covers your mouth and nose, and the best precaution against the volcanic ash is just stay indoors. Don't go outside. Glenn?
Thank you, Kevin. Many of those who braved their way to classes at 8 o'clock this morning did not have, what shall we say, laudatory comments about the man who made that decision to keep the school open. Well, Todd Pickett talked with President Glenn Terrell about what went into that decision this morning.
Dr. Terrell, today has been a particularly hectic one for you, and one in which you've had to change decisions back and forth a little bit regarding the university. Now, this morning, when you got up, situations looked pretty good, I understand, and that was one of the reasons why you decided to leave the university open originally.
Right. Last night when I went to bed, or rather this morning when I went to bed, around 12:30 or 1 o'clock, I was quite certain, actually, that the circumstances were not going to change and that we'd probably be closing the university. But I always like to avoid that if possible. And this morning, when I got up, of course, it looked a lot better. No fallout was continuing. I talked with the university police, with a health official, and with our safety officer, and with a geologist on the campus here. And on the basis of those discussions, concluded that there was no compelling reason to close the university. So I put out the order that we'd be open.
Now, when did those discussions take place?
Between 5 and 6 o'clock this morning.
And then about 8:20 then this morning, we received notice that, again, after some deliberations, a different decision had been made. How did you get to that decision?
The university police called and said the conditions had changed. The wind had picked up in velocity considerably. As a matter of fact, there was very little wind at 6 o'clock or when we made that decision. That changed it perhaps more than anything else. There may have been some underestimation on our part, too, about the effect of automobile traffic. And I think that it was quite clear that there was more dust picked up that was kicked up by vehicular traffic than we had anticipated in our discussions between 5 and 6. Actually, I don't think we figured on people driving like maniacs like they did. I looked out my front window and saw cars going up and down Campus Avenue faster than I'd ever seen them. They looked like they were racing someone and like getting ready for the Indianapolis Speedway. So I think those two factors led the police department to feel that there was a sufficient hazard to vehicular traffic, those involved in that, and also perhaps indirectly pedestrian traffic to justify closing. So I immediately closed in the light of that new information.
Did you ever consider possibly leaving the campus open but then closing to vehicular traffic that might have avoided some of the problems?
Not really. People are so dependent upon their automobiles, and so many come from far enough that they wouldn't have been able to get here, who otherwise would been able to have gotten here had they been able to use their cars. I never really considered that very seriously.
Now, there were some problems in some of the buildings on campus early this morning, most particularly the computer science department, which was having some problems with dust and some ash. Have you heard of any other problems with facilities here on campus?
Have not. Actually, Todd, as it turned out, you see, we were considering safety first, which includes health of students, faculty, and staff. And then I considered also the effect of the fallout on scientific instrumentation and equipment in the university. And it was the last of these that caused me greatest concern at the time I'd made the decision about 6 o'clock this morning, because it was there that it seemed to me that in talking with the doctor and the safety officer that there was no significant hazard for people. But I wasn't sure about whether or not there was a large probability or high probability of damage to equipment until I discussed that quite extensively with the geology faculty member that I talked with. And he concluded, and so did I, that that could be taken care of by precautionary measures, covering sensitive items of equipment or whatever.
If conditions don't change, when do you expect to reach a decision on the opening or closing?
I'd say late afternoon or early evening, and that would have to be contingent upon no further fallout during the course of the evening after that as well. But I think by late afternoon or early evening, we should be able to reach a decision about whether or not our cleanup campaign in the community and on the campus has reached a point where we can reduce that hazard that we experience today to a minimum.
Have you ever had any days that were as unusual and as hectic as this one? This has to rank up there, doesn't it?
They're all that way, just in different ways. And you have to maintain two things. One is calm. I try to keep my head about me. That's the major goal I have in an issue like this. In the late 60s and early 70s, that was the major goal. Whenever there's a crisis of any kind or an emergency like this, I've always felt that if I kept my head about me and my wits about me, others would as well. And that's one reason I try to look at things as much as possible in a business-as-usual vein. And I don't think that decision was affected by that particular predisposition I have under circumstances like this. The first consideration was the safety of our people, and that's the reason I changed the decision when it became apparent to the university police that things were not as safe as they had thought they were earlier in the day because of increased wind velocity.
Well, I think both you and other university officials have done an admirable job in handling this, and thank you for spending time with us as well.
You bet. Appreciate that. Good to be with you, Todd.
On behalf of KWSU Television News, I'm Glenn Johnson. Good night.
Just a drop of water.